Welcome to worship. Although we are not gathering in person, we still intend to gather for worship regularly. Encourage you to gather for your family together wherever you are at the same time you would normally come to church, and we'll provide an online version of worship for you to experience. Obviously, we're very concerned with this coronavirus and its spread, and so we're doing our part to try to suppress the spread by refraining from gathering together for a few weeks, and we look forward to when we can come back together and especially celebrate Holy Communion. Just a couple of announcements. We'll be communicating with you regularly, probably even more so than normal, through email and newsletters. You can go to our website, www.flccs.net, and all of the resources will be there. If you haven't already, go to the Connect button, click that and fill out the form, and you'll be able to subscribe to all of our emails and online publications. Of course, you can find us on social media as well, where we'll be posting these videos. We've had a little fun this week creating a worship experience for you, and we really do pray that it'll be useful to you as you connect with our Lord. And with that in mind, let's pray. Father, we do ask that you would bless all of the members of First Lutheran as we gather for worship separately, that you would keep us having each other in mind, and that we would keep that sense of community together as we check on one another. We pray for those who are especially vulnerable to this virus, that you would protect them from all illness, and that you would keep us safe until we are able to come together and worship again. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us worship together in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
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 May the force be with you.
Also with you.
And also with you.
And also with you.
And also with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel according to John, the fourth chapter. So he came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out by his journey, was sitting by the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." The disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?" Jews did not share things in common with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have no bucket, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well, and with his sons and his flocks drank from it?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give them will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water, so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come back." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I see you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you say that the place where people must worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father seeks such as these to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know the Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will proclaim all things to us." Jesus said to her, "I am he, the one who is speaking to you." Just then his disciples came. They were astonished that he was speaking with a woman, but no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you speaking with her?" Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he?" They left the city and were on their way to him. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you do not know about." So the disciples said to one another, "Surely no one has brought him something to eat." Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me to complete his work. Do you not say 4 months more, then comes the harvest? But I tell you, look around you and see how the fields are ripe for harvesting. The reaper is already receiving wages and is gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor." Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. "He told me everything I have ever done." So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world." The Gospel of the Lord.
So what's your take on this woman at the well? There's a lot of questions about her background, about who she is, about where she comes from. What's she doing bringing water, getting water in the middle of the day? This was a communal activity. People usually gathered with the women of the village in the morning, and they would come and get water together. They would sure gossip with one another, share the stories of the neighborhood, care for one another, work on those relationships. But this woman is coming by herself in the middle of the day. And we have more questions about her when Jesus says, "Go get your husband," and she says, "I have no husband," and he says, "Well, you've had five." Has she had five husbands? Why is the man she's with now not her husband? There's lots of answers we could come up with. Was she an adulteress? Was she promiscuous? Was that why she was alone and wasn't with all of the other women, because she had this bad reputation? Or maybe her husbands had died. Maybe this was a woman full of grief and loneliness and familiar with tragedy and sadness, and that's why she's coming up here by herself. Who knows why she's isolated from the rest of the community? But we know she comes by herself, and Jesus is there, and he's by himself, and he asks for a drink. He asks a woman who is not from his religion or culture. Men were not supposed to talk to women, and still Jesus says, "Give me a drink." And this woman is an independent, strong woman. She pushes back. She has questions. "Why are you talking to me? You're a man, a Jewish man." But Jesus persists in his question, and then he realizes that she's the one who's thirsty, that she's the one who needs spiritual drink, that she needs something that only he can offer. And he uses this metaphor of water, and he says, "If you knew who it is you're talking to, you would ask, and he would give you a gift of God, living water that bubbles up to eternal life." Jesus knows this woman. He knows the answers to the questions that we've asked, and he wants to offer her what she is thirsty for, himself. He wants to offer her the gift of knowing who the Messiah is, knowing that there is a God who knows her, knows everything about her, and loves her with all of his heart, and is willing to accept her and welcome her into his kingdom. And so he pushes back with this question with this woman, and eventually he gets to the point where he can say, "I'm the Messiah." And she is so moved and so transformed by this experience with Jesus that she goes back to her community, the community that she was isolated from, and she tells them this good news about the one who knew everything about her life and who is the Messiah. And many come to believe because of this woman. Now, my question for you this morning is, what are you thirsty for? Not your physical thirst, but your spiritual thirst. We all have thirst. We all have spiritual thirst, that longing in our soul that desires to be filled, the spiritual questions that we have, just the circumstances of our life. I know right now with the coronavirus and all the isolation that people are experiencing, I'm worried about people who are lonely, who need that community and are now separated from it. But I think there's that spiritual thirst that we all have of loneliness and needing community and needing connection to something bigger than ourselves. Certainly the woman at the well knew that spiritual thirst. She experienced isolation. And Jesus is there with her, and Jesus is there with us. He's the one who offers us community. He's the one who lets us know that even when we're alone in quarantine, he is with us. That Jesus is someone we can talk to. Jesus is someone we can learn from and listen to. And so wherever you're listening to this message, know that you're not alone. Jesus is with you in the same way he was with the woman at the well. I think another spiritual thirst that a lot of us have is not having a sense of purpose, losing our sense of meaning in life. You know, think of the woman coming and bringing that bucket up to the well day after day after day. And when Jesus offers her this living water, she's so excited. She says, does that mean I won't have to come up every day and get water, that you can give me this water that never goes away? And of course, he was talking about more than just physical water, but a sense of purpose and meaning. So many of us in our lives, we just find ourselves going through the motions, doing the same thing every day, wondering if it's making any difference, if it's leading anywhere, if it has any purpose or meaning. I know with my son Sam, every morning I get up and I make his medication, I give it to him, and I wonder, does this matter? Is this leading anywhere? Is this going to make him better? And so many of us are going through life like that, doing chores every day, daily activities, whether it's caring for loved ones or just going to work and getting paid or watching our kids. And we wonder, does it matter? Does it lead anywhere? And Jesus comes to us and he says, here's some living water. You can be part of my great work in the world. That yes, what you do matters, that it adds up to something in eternity. So wherever you are right now, whatever thirst you have, whatever spiritual discerning you're going through, I want you to hear the good news of this gospel, that Jesus sees you, he knows you, he loves you, and he offers you himself to quench that thirst, to give you and all of us what we need. Amen.
called together through water and the word, we boldly pray for the church, the world, and all who long to hear God's voice. Here we are at First Lutheran, and this morning we're going to pray for our congregation. Gracious God, we give thanks for all that you have blessed us with. We ask that you be with those in our community, even when we cannot gather together in body today. We ask that you be with us in spirit and take care of all of those who are worshiping in their homes this morning. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of compassion, we come to you asking for your healing among those who are sick. We ask for your protection among all healthcare workers, nurses, physicians, and therapists. And let them know that you are with them, that the Holy Spirit's presence guards them and protects them in all of their work. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for all those families who are affected by this coronavirus outbreak. We pray for students who are home from school that they may continue their learning. We pray for parents who are with them. We pray for all those who are affected by the consequences of schools being closed. We ask that you be with them and guide them as we continue in these weeks together. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, we pray for all of those who are sick and who cannot be with us. We pray for those in our care centers and hospitals. We pray especially for Louis Rossini, for Russ Stott, and for John Ordahl. We lift up all of those who are hospitalized. We also pray for the workers who take care of them. And we ask that you be with them and provide comfort to all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We place our prayers before you, God, united in your spirit through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Pastor Travis, you're forgetting something. The offering. We need to take an offering.
Yeah, but I'm worried about that too, Joan, but I mean, this is a digital format. There's no way, like, I can't put the offering plate through the, I don't know what to do. I think we're just going to have to skip it for now.
No. I have a suggestion here. Let me pull out my cell phone.
What?
And if you take out your cell phone, we'll show you how to do online giving.
We can give through our cell phone?
Yes.
How do you do that?
You just need to go to our website, flccs.net.
Okay, I'm there.
Find the give button.
Look at that. Give.
Wow. And then go down to donate.
Make a donation. Oh, general operating fund, Peel House campaign, something else. All I'm going to give to the general operating fund.
Okay.
So I know ministry goes on.
Right.
And then help offset some processing fee.
Right.
The church has plenty of money. I'm not going to do
that. No, Pastor Travis, I think you could throw in just a little bit extra to help the church out.
You're right. Okay.
Okay.
Check in that box.
And then push donate.
Look at that.
And there you did it.
Thanks, Joan.
How about that?
We don't have to forget the offering after all.
All right.
Appreciate
Thank you.
That.